But in this harsh reality, sometimes I'm so despondent that I feel the need to fly like a bird, take to the sky. I need you now, Lord, carry me high. Don't let the world break me tonight. I need the strength of you by my side. Sometimes this life can be so cold. I pray you'll come and carry me home.
He said he'll never forsake you or leave you alone. Trust him.
All my heart away with with a smile. Take time to tell me you really care and wish
you.
Yeah.
gentlemen, may you please stand.
I can't believe this day has come. I'm in my tux, you're in your wedding gown, and family and friends, they're all staring at us. I know that they can tell that I love them.
In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. God saw all that he had made, and it was very good. The Lord God said, "It is not good for the man to be alone. I will make a helper suitable for him." Then the Lord God made a woman from the rib he had taken out of the man and brought her to the man. In that act, God himself performed the first wedding ceremony and set the example for all homes at all times. We are gathered here today in the sight of God and in the presence of many witnesses to join this man and this woman in holy matrimony. We have gathered to witness and bless their union before God. This is a sacred moment where Christopher and Jenny bring the fullness of who they are as a treasure and a gift from God to share with one another. They bring the dreams which bind them together in an eternal commitment. They bring their gifts and talents, their unique personalities and spirits, which God will unite together into one being as they build their life together. We rejoice with them in thankfulness to the Lord for creating this union of hearts built on friendship, respect, and love. Let us pray. Father, your love is amazing. And we, your children, gather here in this moment to worship you because of that great love shown in the giving of your Son. We thank you for the love shared by this couple. In fact, we celebrate that love and pray for your continued blessing on their lives. Protect, guide, and bless Christopher and Jenny in their marriage. Surround them and us with your presence now and always. In the name of our Lord Jesus the Christ, amen. Amen. Who gives this woman to be married to this man? You may be seated. You come a little bit closer. Today we gather together in the sight of God to celebrate God's sacred calling of marriage. You are witnesses, part of the community that will embrace Christopher and Jenny as they take their vows to be married. Marriage is a covenant they are making to each other that God himself is witnessing. From Ephesians 5, 22 through 24, it says this: "Wives, submit yourselves to your own husbands as you do to the Lord. For the husband is the head of the wife, as Christ is the head of the church, his body, of which he is the Savior. Now as the church submits to Christ, so also wives should submit to their husbands in everything." In this passage, Paul is comparing the relationship of husband and wife to the relationship of Christ and the church. He's clearly telling us that the husband's role is likened unto Christ, and the wife's role is compared to the church. Jenny Marie Phillips. In our culture, submission has become a word that most people run from these days. Yet this is what God's word clearly says. The word has deep meaning and is truly beautiful. Something profound and sacred is taking place in the eyes of God when you get married. God desires the best for you, so he's instructing you on what it means to be married. Submission doesn't mean doing whatever Christopher says or what he wants you to do, especially if it goes against God's word. You know that Christopher is going to make you mad at times, right? Not that that's happened in the past, but something happens when you get married, and it seems to happen more often after you get married. Your But submission, and think about this, submission is not the husband's to command, but for the wife to willingly and lovingly offer. You're doing this because your supreme submission is to the Lord, and God has commanded this is His will for you. He knows what's best for you. Submission is a beautiful thing. Without getting into all the details, let's just leave it at this. God desires that you have a heart attitude of submission in your relationship with Christopher. So, you know, arguments can escalate quickly, and oftentimes it takes one person to stop pushing to stop the argument. Be quick to give in, especially when it really doesn't matter. Jenny, this is the heart attitude God desires for you. In Ephesians 5, 25 through 30, it says this, "Husbands, love your wives just as Christ loved the church and gave himself up for her, to make her holy, cleansing her by the washing with water through the word, and to present her to himself as a radiant church, without stain or wrinkle or any other blemish, but holy and blameless. In this same way, husbands ought to love their wives as their own bodies. He who loves his wife loves himself. After all, no one has ever hated his own body, but they feed and care for their body, just as Christ does the church, for we are members of one body." Christopher Phillip Palmer. As we look at this text, we see that the man is compared to Christ as the head of the church. This is very humbling because in many respects, your responsibility is greater than the wives. What did Christ do? He was a sacrifice. He gave himself for the church. And this is what you're to do in your marriage. You're to be quick to sacrifice for Jenny. Paul gives us the example of the body. Think of how closely you care for the hair of your head, the hairs on your chin. You groom them, you coif, you make sure you look good. In the same way, you're to love your wife as you take care of your own body. Think again about Christ's love for the church. He sacrificed his life for the church, which was imperfect. Jenny is imperfect, and you will have opportunity after opportunity to give up your life for her. This is your calling in marriage as the husband. And your greatest desire for Jenny is that she become perfectly conformed to Christ, leading her to purity. So when the argument escalates with Jenny, maybe you ought to be the first one to back down. You are charged with loving Jenny in a sacrificial way and to encourage her in her faith. This is a sacred calling. Now to the both of you, Ephesians 5, verse 31. "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and be united to his wife, and the two will become one flesh." God's design for marriage is that this union is intimate and unbreakable. The Greek word for united means to adhere, to cleave, to join, to glue, to be glued together, to be cemented together. For this reason, my wife and I many years ago decided early on in our marriage never to use the D word. I'm not talking about swearing, I'm talking about divorce. To never threaten each other with divorce. When divorce is an option, it's easy to go there. When divorce isn't an option, you're left with a choice of staying the same or working to improve it. And it's a beautiful thing to watch and see how a marriage blossoms as a husband and wife work together. In the covenant of marriage, you are joined in such a way you're glued that it's designed to be permanent. A few years back, research was conducted on rocky marriages and how they turned out. And you know what the number one thing that couples identified as being the thing that changed their marriage for the good? It was they realized they needed to stop calling each other names. No matter how mad they got at each other, they stopped calling each other names. The words of our mouth can bring life, or they can bring death to our marriage. It's easy to call each other names when we get mad at each other. And it's easy to want to quit when the going gets rough. And I'm going to read to you a letter that was sent to Abraham Lincoln. This is a letter that I read to my daughter when she was married a year and a half ago. It's powerful, and I believe it's fitting for all weddings. It was the summer of 1862 during the Civil War, and Abraham Lincoln was president. The average age in the army was 20. His army had been battered, and there were lots of complaining mothers. One day, Lincoln received a letter from a mother who said that her son was finding it hard and wanted to quit. After reading the letter, Lincoln penned a letter to the son and said the following words. Your good mother tells me you are feeling very badly in your new situation. Allow me to assure you, it is a perfect certainty that you will very soon feel better. Quite happy if you only stick to the resolution you have taken to procure a military education. Your good mother, he says, I am older than you, have felt badly myself, and I know what I tell you is true. Adhere to your purpose, and you will soon feel as well as you ever did. On the contrary, if you falter and give up, you will lose the power of keeping any resolution and will regret it the rest of your life. Take the advice of a friend who, though he never saw you, deeply sympathizes with you, and stick, adhere to your purpose. So Jenny, adhere to your purpose in cultivating this spirit of submission. And Christopher, adhere to your purpose in being a sacrificial leader in the home, always honoring and bringing glory to God in your marriage. And lastly, as Peter tells us in 1 Peter 4, verse 8, above all, love each other deeply because love covers over a multitude of sins. You will disappoint each other. You will fail at times in your responsibilities. The love and grace that God demonstrated to us by our Lord Jesus Christ is the love and grace that you're to demonstrate towards each other in marriage. This is what makes marriage beautiful. Here's the idea. When we submit to God, He gives us the strength to submit to one another. This is why cultivating a spirit of submission and sacrifice is such a beautiful thing. God's plan brings unity when things go awry. His plan brings reconciliation. God reconciled us to Him through Jesus Christ, and you and Christopher are to be reconciled to each other in your marriage. It's hard, but a beautiful thing. We can't do it by our own strength, but by submitting our lives to Christ. He'll give you the strength. Your marriage is to demonstrate the gospel in living color. So as Abraham Lincoln counseled the young soldier who wanted to quit, when your marriage becomes difficult, may you adhere to your purpose. Adhere to your purpose, Jenny. Adhere to your purpose, Christopher. May you hold firm in your commitment to each other. May you hold firm in your commitment to honor God in your marriage. And may God richly bless you as you embark upon a long and fruitful marriage. The couple will now exchange vows.
I, Chris, take you, Jenny, to be my wife and my one true love. I love you because you're strong, caring, smart, and you never stop believing in me. So in front of God and all our friends and families, I vow to never stop working on us. I vow to always work on keeping your love tank full. I promise to keep myself open to you, to let you into my thoughts, my feelings, and my fears, and my dreams. I promise to continue to grow along with you and be willing to face change, keeping our relationship alive and exciting. And finally, I promise to love you in good times and bad times, with all my love completely and forever.
I, Jenny, take you, Chris, to be my husband and my one true love. When I say I love you, I am saying that I am accepting you for the person you are, that I do not want you to change into someone else. It doesn't mean I expect perfection from you, just like you don't expect it from me. It means that I will always love you, stand by you, even through the worst times. I will love you even through the bad moods or even if you're too tired to do things I want to do. It means when you're down, not just when you are fun to be around. I love you. I love you means I know your deepest secrets and not judge you for them, as you do not judge me for mine. It means that I have always cared enough to fight for what we have and always will. And that I love you enough to never let you go. I think of you, I dream of you, and admire you for the man that you are, the father you are, and the husband you will become. Christopher, I promise to take care of you, be your best friend, your shoulder to lean on, and to love you for the rest of our living days together.
May I have the rings, please? There are many things that you will remember this day for years to come, that will help you remember this day from years to come. But your rings have a special message and will be the one ever-present reminder of this hour. The wedding ring is an outward symbol of the couple's inward bond, illustrating with an unending circle the eternal quality of love. The rings also represent resources. In the exchanging of rings today, Christopher and Jenny are symbolically giving all of their resources, their wealth, their possessions, their talents, their emotions to one another. Christopher, repeat these words after me. This ring is a symbol of my unending love for you. I give you all my earthly possessions, which God has given to me. From this moment forward, may this circle of gold, which never ends, be a symbol of God's constant, unchanging love, which He gave to me to give to you for the rest of our lives. Jenny, repeat these words after me. This ring is a symbol.
This ring is a symbol
of my unending love for you.
Of my unending love for you.
I give you all my earthly possessions.
I give you all my earthly possessions.
Which God has given to me.
Which God has given to me.
From this moment forward.
From this moment forward.
May this circle of gold.
May this circle of gold.
Which never ends.
Which never ends.
Be a symbol of God's.
Be a symbol of God's.
Constant, unchanging love.
Constant, unchanging love.
Which He gave to me,
which He gave to me,
to give to you,
to give to you,
for the rest of your lives,
for the rest of our lives.
Christopher and Jenny have chosen to symbolize their union of two families into one by having members of their family pour individual vials of sand into one. This will serve as the first of many experiences of unity as a husband and a wife. They have separated themselves from their respective families and former lives and have now formed a new family unit.
It seems like forever that I have waited for you. In a world of disappointment, one thing is true. God has blessed me, and He's blessed you too. In a world of lonely people, I found you. Take my hand and hold me close, and don't let me go. Together we'll make one. We were once strangers all by ourselves, living alone with no one else. But here you are, and it's so God must have done this, made you for me, and one.
My prayer for you, Christopher and Jenny, comes from Romans 15, verses 5 through 7. Let us pray. May the God who gives endurance and encouragement give you a spirit of unity among yourselves as you follow Christ Jesus, so that with one heart and voice you may glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you accept one another, just as Christ accepted you, in order to bring praise to God. May the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God the Father and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you both. Amen. For as much as Christopher and Jenny have consented in holy matrimony and have witnessed the same before God and these witnesses, have pledged their faith to each other, declared the same by joining hands, making vows, giving and receiving of rings, and by the unity ceremony, by the power invested in me by God, I now pronounce you husband and wife. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Whom God has joined together, let no man put asunder. Christopher, you may kiss the bride. Ladies and gentlemen, with a heart full of joy, I give to you Mr. and Mrs. Christopher Palmer.
Chris, take you, Jenny, to be my wife and my one true love. I love you because you're strong, caring, smart, and you never stop believing in me. So in front of God and all our friends and families, I vow to never stop working on us. I vow to always work on keeping your love tank full. I promise to keep myself open to you, to let you into my thoughts, my feelings, and my fears, and my dreams. I promise to continue to grow along with you and be willing to face change, keeping our relationship alive and exciting. And finally, I promise to love you in good times and bad times with all my love completely and forever.
Hi, Jenny. Take you, Chris, to be my husband and my one true love. When I say I love you, I am saying that I am accepting you for the person you are, that I do not want you to change into someone else. It doesn't mean I expect perfection from you, just like you don't expect it from me. It means that I will always love you, stand by you, even through the worst times. I will love you even through the bad moods, or even if you're too tired to do things I want to do. It means when you're down, not just when you are fun to be around. I love you. I love you means I know your deepest secrets and not judge you for them, as you do not judge me for mine. It means that I have always cared enough to fight for what we have and always will. And that I love you enough to never let you go. I think of you, I dream of you, and admire you for the man that you are, the father you are, and the husband you will become. Christopher, I promise to take care of you, be your best friend, your shoulder to lean on, and to love you for the rest of our living days together.
I give to you Mr. and Mrs. Christopher Palmer.